Hello and welcome to Data Queries Without Systems, where we're going to cover the ways you can retrieve data from a database and look into what is the format that this data is made available to your code. Now there's two ways, two different statements whereby you can retrieve data from the database. It's the aggregates and the SQL queries. The aggregates are the preferred way to retrieve data from the database as they require no SQL knowledge on your part. They also scale very well with the data as you develop your data, as you increase, for example, the number of attributes in an entity. And it also has the advantage that since you will be working with the UI, the compiler can look at the context whereby this query is being used and optimize the actual compiled code for you. Then there's the SQL queries. Now you should leave these for more advanced scenarios where you want to write something very, very specific and you want to access certain database specific features. Likewise, this is the way to go if you need to write a statement, a SQL statement that is not a query. So for example, an insert, update, delete. And we will have a slide on that. Now, regardless of which of the flavors of queries that you select, the output of a query is actually similar. It will be made up of a list, which is the result set of the query, plus a count, which is an integer that indicates the number of records that query is returning. Furthermore, it's important for you to note, looking at the right-hand side of the slide, that inside the list, you have several runtime properties that are marked here as green squares, the most important of which is the current. Now, the current is one atom of the type that the query is outputting. So in this case, the query is clearly fetching clients, so the atom will be a client with its attributes. Now, immediately after a query is performed, this current will be pointing at the very first record in the result set. Should the query not return any results, this client, for example, will have the default values for each of its attributes. The most important thing to note, though, is if you access this current inside an iteration, and you can see a for each node at the very bottom of the slide, this current will actually be moving across the list that was returned. So accessing a current inside an iteration is the way for a developer, for example, to process every single record. The other properties are less important and you can look them up in the platform documentation. Let's look then in more detail on the aggregate statement. The aggregates are very convenient because they allow you to visually design your queries and test it even before publishing your module. You set an aggregate up by configuring it in four tabs, which is the sources, the filters, the sorting, and the test values. Let's look at the sources first. Now, you can have a very simple query that only deals with one particular entity, but aggregates support you selecting more than one entity. You can see here on the screenshot in this slide that we have two entities, a client and a product, that are related somehow via a join. Let's look then at some of the flavors, well, actually the three types of flavors that you can create joins inside aggregates. And for that purpose, we're going to be working with two different tables, two different entities. So you have the issues entity on the left-hand side of your screen, and the engineers entity on the right hand side of the screen. And you can see that issues are handled by specific engineers. Let's see how we can retrieve information using these two entities and the join types. If you opt to have a join of the kind only with, in this particular case, we're retrieving issues only with engineers, effectively you'll only get rows whereby the issue has been assigned to an engineer. If an issue is unassigned, this will not be in the result set. And this is the equivalent to a SQL inner join. If you opt for a with or without kind of join, then you will get all the rows from the left entity, even if there is no matching in the right entity. So over here, we can see on the left-hand side, issues, regardless of them having an engineer or not, and on the right-hand side, we're seeing the query the other way around. We're actually fetching the engineers, even if they have no issues associated with them. So in a sense, this is the equivalent to a SQL left join. Finally, you have the most permissive join, the with. In this case, you will return all rows from both entities, even when there isn't a match. And you can see that conveyed in the screenshot on the right-hand side. Now, on the output of your aggregates, you will get all of the entities that make up the sources for it. So if you have the product and the client, you'll have product and client. If you desire to have one or more extra attributes that are computed, you can create ad-hoc attributes. And over here, you see a few screenshots that tell you how you could calculate the total price of a particular product, having in mind the amount that you're actually purchasing. These extra ad-hoc attributes will show up in the output of the query next to the entities that are the sources of the query. It's important to note that when you're designing an aggregate, you have the preview always on your screen and you're able to hide and show columns on that preview. Please note that this will not influence the actual output. This is just for preview purposes only. The actual output is then, upon compilation, optimized to the actual columns that the remainder of your code uses from the output of this aggregate. And this is a very handy and very powerful feature in the OutSystems platform, and that is exclusive to the aggregates. One last point relating to the sources and therefore the outputs of the queries is the capability to aggregate the values. So you're actually able to use aggregate functions like sum, average, maximum, minimum, and count on your result set. Please note that as soon as you start to aggregate functions, as it would be the case if you were to use a group by on SQL, only the aggregated attributes will appear in the output record of the query. So in this example, for the result of this particular query, this particular aggregate, we'll just have one column, which is count. And you can see that because it's highlighted in blue. Moving swiftly on to filters, this is very simple. This is effectively the where clauses, where you're able to filter the result set, having in mind, for example, other variables that are in the scope where this query is being executed. So right here, what we're seeing is we're retrieving clients that have an ID that's the same of some variable on the outside called input client ID. For preview purposes, these inputs that you can use in filter, they show up in the test values tab, allowing you at design time to try out what is the result set of this aggregate depending on input values that you put into these test values. In closing, all that remains to be talked about is the sorting. You have in the aggregates interface a dedicated tab for that, and you can select as many attributes as you want. The order is obviously important. You can decide if it's ascending or descending. If you particularly need a dynamic sorting, you specify to the query a text that dictates what column it should sort by. Please note that the syntax of this text is very specific and it's highlighted on the left-hand side of the slide. Let's look now at SQL queries, also sometimes called advanced queries. So what do SQL queries look like? As you can see, the interface for SQL queries is much simpler, and it's basically these three panels. The way to go about writing SQL queries is you specify which input parameters this query has access. You then specify what is the record format that should be in the output of it, and you can select entities and structure, combine them to create this output structure, and then it's up to you to write the SQL of the query. The editor provides some guidance by doing some SQL syntax checking and highlighting of colors as you type in your SQL. So to recap, unlike aggregates, SQL queries are actually black boxes, so they don't see anything on the outside that you don't pass in as an explicit parameter. You need to specify the types of these parameters. You also need to specify the entities and structures that make up the output. And in the SQL panel, you can write freeform SQL statements, having in mind that you need to place your entities inside curly brackets, your attributes inside square brackets, and any parameters preceded by the at character. The second tab allows you to specify input values to test your query, similarly to the aggregates. On the third tab, Test output, when you perform the test, you will be able to see the rows that were returned. And finally, on the fourth tab, if you're so interested, you can look at the actual SQL code that was generated by the compiler. One final usage for SQL statements is to write non-query SQL statements. So if you need to do a delete or an update or an insert and you do not want to use an entity action, you will need to use a SQL statement. And even though these statements don't normally produce any output, you'll still need to specify some dummy output entity or structure. In closing, let's just look at how you can convey multiple entities or structures together into a single record. Here's a slide that you might remember from the data modeling lesson that just shows and recaps how the output of a query looks like once you use it in future statements. So you have the query's got an output, which is a list, and it has the current in this particular case, which is only got customer inside. So a single record. However, most queries actually return more than one entity when, for example, you perform a join, as we mentioned. In this case, the query.list will have side by side the entities that the query has returned and any extra columns in case you created ad hoc columns. In the example shown, you can see that we're creating an output variable of the action get all movies in cinemas based on the return type of get movies with cinemas. Notice how the data type picker suggests the outputs of queries that exist within this scope to create a type that is a combination of cinema, movie, and movie session. The key point that I want to make here is that we're not limited to queries to have access to lists of records, including of multi-entity records. You can create variables and you can specify a complex type for those variables. In fact, if rather than taking a suggestion, you select Data Type Editor, you will see this dialog and you can add whatever entity, whatever structure, or whatever individual basic type to make up the record format that this particular variable has. In this particular case, I added an extra text attribute that I called extra text attribute to the output that was already in the all movies in cinemas variable. And that's basically it for data queries. See you guys in the next lesson.